Good afternoon all. Nice to see you all here. I grew up in a small town called Pofri. Pofri is situated in the Konkan region of the Western Ghats. Here you can see the pictures of the Pofri. As a kid, I have many memories of this town. As a kid, I used to crisscross the hills around Pofri, used to taste carissa berries without hesitating. I learned swimming in our own natural swimming pool, and I always believed that all this wealth belongs to me. Education for a career took this kid away from Pofri. After a few years, I returned to Pofri, and what I saw was heartbreaking. So this is Pofri in 2005, and this is where I learned swimming. And you can see in the next picture. So this is Pofri in 2010, 16 maybe. You can see the water is completely gone. And this was really heartbreaking for me. I saw that there were many things that changed, and there was a massive land transformation that happened. I think some of you can relate with these if you have been to a small hometown. When you return back after a few years, you see that there are so many things that have been changed. So feeling bad about what is going to happen to this earth and feeling bad about what's happening now is very much part of my profession of wildlife research. I see burning forests, massive land transformation, exponentially rising urban sprawl, and the conflict that results from it. The sad reality is that whoever wins loses. Well, I'm not going to go into the details of the land transformation, whether it's good or bad, but one thing is clear. The land transformation is basically takes up changes for which we are neither prepared nor will be soon. The land use change is not just about losing forest. It is about losing the very elements that make the forest. Well, again, forest is not just a patch of standing trees. What forest is really about is the tiniest of insects, the largest of mammals that dwell in it. Not only trees and animals, but the people, the culture, the voices, and the music that lives in it. Forest, whether it's evergreen, scrubland, or grassland, is a hotspot for preservation of this ecological interaction. From the most human-centric view, I would argue that forests serve us in so many ways by providing rains and oxygen, temperature regulation, carbon sequestration, improving the fertility of the land, improving the productivity of farms, and so on, aesthetics as well. So forest, again, as a whole acts. It's not only trees, not only the animals that act. Same thing applies to our wetlands. Each and every component in this system matters and has a role to play. Conserving these elements is the least that we can do. We are far from understanding the complexity of life. The least that we can do is appreciate it. This is our biodiversity, and we should be proud of it. In my career as an evolutionary ecologist, I have been to many different places, such as the Western Ghats, the Central India, and Andaman Islands. In Western Ghats, I worked on biodiversity mapping for 2 years in Sayadri Tiger Reserve, where I came across a lot of variety of flora and fauna, some of them such as deadliest Malabar pit viper over here. In Central India, I spent 5 years tracking this elusive bird called forest owlet, which you can see in the picture over here. This is one of the rarest owls that we have in India, and this is the rarest owl in world, across worldwide. So this species is endemic to India, but sadly, there was very little information available on the species. What are the threats to the species, and where the species is located, and what is the evolutionary history of the species? We worked as a team on this species for the last 5 years, and we decoded its genetics, and now we have a lot of information coming on the ecology and evolutionary history of the species, and now we are able to give recommendation based on this information for the land use policy. When I worked in Andamans, I was a part of a bigger project on conservation of edible nest swiftlets. These are tiny birds which make their nest using their saliva. Their saliva is full of protein. You can see the nest in the slide. And the problem with these nests is that people think that these are highly nutritious nests, and they basically take this nest away and they make a soup out of it, which is very famous worldwide. It is exported out and so on. So late Dr. Ravi Shankaran identified this problem, and it's a huge conservation problem because their population was declining. So he identified that there are poachers who are actually farmers who go and poach these nests, and then they make soup out of it and sell in the local market. So what he simply did, he employed those poachers as conservators, as protectors of the nest sites. These nests occur in deep caves. So he basically employed them to protect those nests, protect those caves, and in return, he gave them some incentives, like a salary. So what that is all they want money. And at the end of this harvesting, you can take up the nest, and then you can sell in the local market again. So in a way, there was a system which was created. Now this project is still running, and I was happy to be a part of that project. So throughout my journey through time, I have been to multiple places. I have roamed in some of the remotest forests of India. I have been to places where nobody reached. I heard some of the beautiful trees that no one noticed. And I saw changing forests while no one cared. I realized that for the conservation to work, what we need to understand and appreciate is the biodiversity, which we take for granted. Unless the connect, the environmental problems do not look real. And that is what prompted us to think about an idea of citizen science initiative in India. Another major issue that we have in India is lack of knowledge of regional flora and fauna. For many areas, we do not even know what exists out there, and if there are ill effects of habitat degradation and human-mediated climate change on it. So what we require is a lot of data coming in. And that is when we started thinking about citizen science. So what is citizen science? Citizen science is a collective public participatory effort to collect data. And based on that data, you can answer multiple scientific questions. So here, anyone can be a citizen scientist, irrespective of educational background. What you simply have to do is go out in the field and collect data on species presences and then upload it on a website. What you simply need is a smartphone. A smartphone is the best device to collect data about species presences and map it on a website. So you collect the data on a smartphone. As each smartphone now we know that comes with an inbuilt camera and a GPS, which is the bare minimal requirement for documenting and mapping species. So you simply collect the data, and then you can upload the data on multiple citizen science portals, which are nothing but specialized websites. Any researcher can access this data, and then he or she can study biodiversity dynamics and then come up with landscape policies. For instance, here is a map of Kolhapur city, and these are some of the observations I have downloaded from a citizen science portal. Obviously, there are major gaps here. As you can see that only few areas are occupied. And a lot of documentation is required if you want to really understand what's happening within this city, right? So we built upon these concepts and created a group called Dragonfly India. Now, Dragonfly India started as a small mailing community of researchers and enthusiasts who were interested in dragonflies. No, but why study dragonflies? I mean, what's so special about them? Dragonflies are one of the most sensitive taxa when it comes to freshwater habitats. We know that our wetlands are degrading, and there is no check on it. By observing presences or absence of certain species or groups of species of dragonflies, you can ascertain the health of the habitat. So what basically it needs is regular monitoring of these species presences. Now here you can see that dragonflies are everywhere around us. Just before the monsoon arrives, you might have seen skies full of orange-colored pantala dragonflies. And it's a pattern that you see every year. Dragonflies everywhere around us, and you can see that there are multiple colored dragonflies, and they have been here on the Earth since the beginning, almost the beginning of the time, like 300 million years ago. They evolved, and they're still here. And we just came right now, right? So these are ancient insects, and most of the evolutionary puzzles can be solved by studying dragonflies as well. So we built upon this concept, and we took dragonfly as our interest group, and we started building this group called Dragonfly India. We started with a very small community, but as of now, we have 9,000 plus members across social media and citizen science portals. Imagine there are at least 9,000 plus people who are looking for dragonflies wherever they go within India. I mean, that's insane, right? So what we did next was, these are virtual users, okay? You need to show them some faces, some expert faces, so that they become more interested. And that's when we come up with an idea of a meeting. So these meetings are called Dragonfly India meetings, which are basically annual national meetings where anyone can participate. These meetings provide an interface between experts and laymen. So now people come and we educate them in the art of dragonfly watching. Now they go out, they watch dragonflies, and they fall in love, of course. And then we discuss the many conservation issues that plague us. So the Dragonfly India group, over the years, has grown really huge. And now I'm happy to share that we have members from multiple South Asian countries. And people have termed it now as Dragonfly South Asia community. So it has really grown big. And people have gone crazy about these dragonflies. Dragonfly India has come up over the years with multiple publications, many research expeditions, many new species have been discovered, and there is a massive amount of data that has been flowing across India on the species presences and the geographical distributions. Now, people are looking for dragonflies. Dragonflies have become glamorous insects. Insects which have their own voice when it comes to devising landscape policy. We have become the voice of dragonflies. Following the success of Dragonfly India, we have initiated multiple other citizen science initiatives. For instance, there is Owl India, where people again have gone crazy about finding owls and reporting them. And there is another one called Roadkill Network. So Roadkill Network basically aims at mapping the roadkills across India. You know, there are multiple casualties which happen as a road accident while animals are crossing the road. And this is a very serious threat when it comes to the wildlife. So roads may have a lot of major impact on the wildlife movement, and that is what we have been mapping across India. And people are now really contributing a lot of data. So these communities will grow, and this data will be utilized to understand the biodiversity dynamics and how biodiversity responds to the disturbances that we create. There is another big major group called eBird, which is maintained by Cornell Lab of Ornithology. They have come up with this mesmerizing map of bird migration. These are 118 species. Each dot represents one species. And this map was possible only because thousands of citizen scientists contributed their data. Now, this is what I'm talking about. This is what we require. We require massive amounts of data. We require thousands of citizen scientists to come up, share their data, share their knowledge, so that we can understand our biodiversity very well. eBird could achieve this because there was a connect that eBird created between people and the birds. And that is what I'm talking about. If we really want to understand what's happening around us, we need to connect with the nature. This connect is actually there. It's a long-lasting bond that remains between us and the nature. It's just that it's forgotten. All we need to do is inquire. Thank you.